I bought this laptop on eBay for £9. It's a HP Omnibook 900 from the late 1990s. It's not in great condition. We've got missing hinges, a missing key, sticky tape on it. It's seen better days. But I want to put Windows NT Workstation onto this and get it back up and running. Let's go through and have a look and see what parts we've got, what's missing, and if it'll boot up. Okay, so we have hinge damage on both sides of the laptop, but it is aesthetic. The hinge works, as you can see. So that's purely aesthetically pleasing, and we can hopefully find the covers for that, because I think that's all that's missing is the hinge covers. There's also a key missing off the keyboard, so we'll either try and find that individual key or maybe just replace the whole keyboard in its entirety. Over here is the bay for the hard disk, which contains no hard disk. There's nothing in there. So that means a replacement hard drive and caddy for that. The plastic covers at the back are also damaged across the back port selection. That's going to be pretty hard to get hold of, I think. Might be something I'm going to have to put up with. It's not going to affect the performance of the laptop, and it's going to be pretty tricky to get hold of those parts. Other than it being a bit grubby, and we'll clean this old sellotape off here, it's in reasonably decent shape. And if we have a look on the bottom of the laptop, we can see here that it was running Windows NT Workstation. And it's my intention to put Windows NT Workstation back onto this and get it running with that operating system. Right, let's boot her up. It's a promising start. We've got green lights at the front and flashing. Okay, Phoenix BIOS 4. That's good. Post beep, BIOS information. I imagine nothing because we've got no hard drive in it. Yeah, operating system not found. Okay, that's a decent start. Next thing I think is to get into the BIOS and see what settings are in there. This laptop was built on the 11th of November, 1999. Into the BIOS. Standard settings for date and time. Let's have a look at this internal hard disk setting. There's no hard drive in at the moment, so it can't detect anything. Okay, none of those are relevant because we don't have a disk in at present. Down to quiet boot, that is disabled, so we can see the screen as we boot up. And this was the option here. There's a couple of options for external graphics cards that you can use, and some with a dock that would have come with this device. Pretty much all this system devices are enabled. PS2, which supported the external keyboard that we've plugged in. Both types of mouse, that's the trackpad and an external mouse. You can use left control instead of a function key. Hard drive controller, floppy disk controller enabled. Serial port enabled. I note the infrared port is disabled. Notice an early setting there for removable device boot, which allowed you to boot from USB disk. On the power management settings, this is set for maximum performance, which gives 15 minutes before the hard drive times out. What happens if we switch it to max power savings? 2 minutes. Well, that's not a fat lot in it. I'm going to switch it back because I want to get the maximum amount of time of using this before anything shuts down. There's settings here for what to do when you press the power button. I'm going to change that so that it goes off when I press the power button. And the lid switch is set to just turn the display off. That's fine. I'm going to keep that one in place. In the boot menu, it's going to boot first from removable drive, floppy, then the hard disk, and then from a CD-ROM DVD drive. Of course, the challenge with this is that we don't have the floppy drive and we don't have the CD-ROM drive. Here lies the trickier problem with this model of laptop. It was designed to be very portable and relatively thin for the time, with a good display, this XFT display on it. However, it compromised a couple of things, and that was no optical drive, no CD-DV drive, no floppy disk drive. You had to have an external caddy bay, which you can see here on the screen, which was a multi-purpose caddy. There's two displayed here for sale on a website, that you only needed one, and you slotted in a unit for the CD drive and you slotted in a unit for the DVD drive. Let's see if we can get a better example in that photo. There's one. You can see here on the screen, there's an empty bay, and that's where you'd slot in the unique individual floppy or CD drive. Problem is trying to get hold of one of these. This is the only thing I can find at the moment, which is the external CD floppy drive adapter bay at $69 coming from America with $51 on shipping. Plus probably any taxes I have to pay. I might be looking at putting down £150 to get that to the United Kingdom, which is a lot of money to get your hands on a CD floppy drive bay, because it hasn't even got the bay for inside it. That's just the adapting space. It hasn't got the floppy drive or CD. So I've got a different plan and approach for this laptop.
But we have got a problem here with this, and that is here, we don't have a hard disk, and we also don't have the bay that the hard disk sits in. I'm going to get my phone out here to record this to see whether we can get a better image of what's going on inside here. I'm going to just use the phone. And can you see there, right at the back, there is a connector. Now that is not the connector for a standard IDE drive, 2.5 inch. That is a custom backplane connector that comes as part of the caddy that comes with the Omnibook. And we don't have it. So we're going to have to get on eBay and see if we can find it, because there's no way to connect a hard disk to this laptop without that connector.
The good news is I found one. I never thought I would, but here it is. The only one I can find on eBay is this connector. However, there was a slight tricking part to it. It's in Knoxville, Tennessee in the United States. So I asked the seller, would they ship to the United Kingdom? And they said no, but I wasn't going to be perturbed by that. So I used a service whereby I can buy it in the United States and it ships to a mailing address in Florida. And then that company will then ship it to your own address in the United Kingdom or whichever country you want. And they charge you a handling fee for that. So the device itself, $11.99, not expensive at all. Turned out it cost me $22 to ship it back to the United Kingdom. So nearly £30 it cost me. And here it is. I have it. This is the backplane connector for the HP Omnibook. On the back, you probably can't make that out, but there are the 22-pin connector for the IDE drive. And this end is what connects into that backplane that we saw in the previous few moments. That means we can now put a hard drive into this laptop. So what we need to do now is come back and replace the keyboard for it as well, which I've picked up on eBay, and I managed to get the keyboard in the United Kingdom for £13 brand new. So the next thing I'm going to do now is replace the keyboard so that we can start using the laptop and start the process of getting an operating system on it. Keyboard replacement. The keyboard screws are underneath this front panel here, which on this one slips off that easily because this here doesn't grip as well as it once did. It's got some of its plastic clips broken. So we've got screws here and here holding the keyboard in place. Remove those. Used to do quite a lot of these in the late 90s, early noughties, repairing keyboards, replacing keyboards, changing components and stuff on laptops. Happened to do less of those as time went on, as they became more of a disposable item, unfortunately. But at this time in history, they were still repairable. So you lift the keyboard up, and then it's got a ribbon cable here that connects to the board, and here that connects to the board. And these are just a matter of pulling them out. They sort of just push in. Pull that one out there. So you can get some focus. You can see that there's just a firm plastic strip that pushes into place. So we will get out the new keyboard here. Brand new with this here, which was a technology. This you might recognize if you're a ThinkPad user from IBM, the classic, as some called it, nipple. That was actually licensed by HP from IBM for the 900 Omnibook series. It wasn't a HP patent. That was IBM's, and it was licensed by them. Now you've got to get these back into these two slots here, which can be a little bit tricky. It sort of depends. I think if I remember, I think the first one's probably going to be okay. What you're trying to do here is put it in with a bit of force, but not too much force that you bend or break anything. That's the sort of key to it. And this small one's a bit trickier to do. Oh, yep. Yes, I've heard that. That's seated. They're both seated. So that should slide back onto place. That sits down. We put the screws in it. And then we're going to have to put some power through it and hope that this works, because it'll be annoying if the keyboard's broken because the keyboard isn't broken. But I'm hopeful that it is the keyboard, because I did see quite a lot of these in my younger days as an engineer. Keyboards did break, or people spilt stuff on them and we would replace them. And this should, there we go, it's all clipped back into place. Right. I'm going to be back in a moment. Let's get some power.
I'm going to go for F2 to get into the BIOS. And with a bit of luck, we're going to have a working keyboard. Yes, it's detected F2. That's a promising start. Now, can I move through the BIOS once we get into it? Yes. Working keyboard. Fabulous. Something I have noticed with the laptop is when I switch it on, the fan sounds a little worry, which means it may be full of dust, it may need replacing, and it might cause the laptop to overheat. But before we get to that and have a look at that, I just want to mention that it would be rather appreciated if you would like and subscribe to the channel, because it means a lot to me. It's a lot of fun, and we would like to get more people here. And I say we, because it's only me. I would like to get more people here, and I suppose my daughters would like that too. Right. Let's get on to getting underneath this keyboard again. I've already taken the first two sets of screws out of this. So we can lift this out of the way here. And this here is the heatsink. And underneath this heatsink here is a fan that sits here. Because these laptops came with full schematics, which I can stick up on the screen for you to have a quick look at while I remove these screws. And I rather like the fact that they came with full schematics. You don't really get that anymore, because so much stuff now will be soldered direct onto the motherboard and won't be a replaceable part. But this is from the era when servicing these laptops was expected. It was something that either you would do yourself or a HP engineer would come out and do for you. You would take the heatsink out there, and we can see here is the fan. And what I'm going to do is blow a bit of compressed air through that. It's spinning nicely there. It's got a little bit of whir to it, which suggests that potentially the bearings come at it the other way. Yeah, potentially the bearings aren't the very best in that, but I think we're probably just going to have to stick with that for now. So I'm going to put this back together again, and we will come across the next issue, which is getting an operating system on it. And I can also show you something I've noticed, that if the screen's not in the right position, it's not displaying any image on it. I thought at first point the laptop had actually failed on me, but it hasn't. It is the movement and location of the screen which suggests something that's happening in here or here, where the connections are going into the screen is loose when it's moving, and that is causing a problem. So for now, I'm leaving it open all the time so that we can actually do the work on it that we need to do. Okay, hard disk needed for the HP laptop. Now, the HP came with originally a 6 GB drive, but they're actually really hard to get hold of at the moment. So what I'm going for here is this, which is an SSD disk at 32 GB. But obviously, as you can see, that's not going to fit into the laptop in that form factor. So what I've got for it is a caddy bay here that has the connection points for 44 pin
2.5 inch IDE, and that's what I'm going to use. And what you do with this is this plugs in to here, and then a couple of screws will pin that down in place, and the HP will see this as an IDE drive. Because I could go out and buy one of the, it was 4, 6, and the maximum was 12 for the 900 Omnibook. But the prices are pretty high. I think the best value I could get on a 6 gig IDE was £22. And that was rare. I think most of them were pushing, some were pushing over £100. So pretty expensive stuff for those old ones. Now, this then goes inside this here, as so, and has tiny, tiny, tiny screws that go there. And then on here, that's not going to plug in, because remember I mentioned this fellow. That has to go on. And IDEs, they have a, we're going to get it, probably not going to get a focus on here on it, but there is a guide pin, or there is a missing pin, which goes into the missing gap on there, as so. So that will fit on like that. Now that will slide inside the laptop. This is seen as a hard disk in the BIOS, and then we can install the operating system. I wasn't sure if the Omnibook was going to make a good build, but I'm confident now that it is. Finding the keyboard was a real bonus in the UK, but the most important part was finding that backplane adapter for the hard disk drive. And now we've got that, I can get a hard disk in it. So the challenge in the next video is how to get the operating system on it. I've got a key underneath for Windows NT workstation, possibly the most difficult of all operating systems to install from about 1999. I may switch to Windows 98 to see if we can actually get the entire laptop to work. In the next video, I'm going to take you through the process of how we're going to install an operating system onto a laptop with no CD drive, no floppy disk drive. How are we going to boot it? Well, stick around for the next one and I'll show you how we get it done. Cheers. See you next time. Ta-da. (Clears throat)